Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to TechGig webinar series, our endeavor to empower techies. We believe that sharing of knowledge is the key to enhance our skills and grow us as professionals. With this principle in mind, we initiated a series of webinars conducted by industry experts to give you all a crisp insight of various domains. The topic of today's session is advanced data visualization, how you can use it to your advantage. Our guest speaker today is Shitij Ashtekar, Big Data Analytics Lead at Accenture. Shitij leads Big Data Analytics and in Accenture and is responsible for capability and offering development across emerging technologies. He has over 17 years of work experience in IT, including 12 years in Accenture. He has over 16 years of experience in the data and analytics space and has delivered complex large-scale data warehousing projects across 11 countries in telecom and finance industries. He has done assignments and device analytics strategies for many companies, especially mutual fund and non-life insurance companies. So without further delay, I introduce you all to our guest speaker. Over to you, Shitij.
Hey, thanks a lot. Hi all. Welcome to the session. Thanks for taking out time on your Friday afternoon. I hope this session will be good for you as a closing session for the weekend. It's going to be a light session and I hope that you will enjoy it. We're going to be covering this topic, data visualization, which has been kind of flaring up over the last couple of years. We will take a look at the different aspects of data visualization, what's happening in the technology space, and we certainly will take you through a couple of demos for sure. With that, let me start the session without taking much time. Trying to follow and see who all are trying to attend the session so that I can make sure that the content is tailored and is good enough for the people who are joining in, and that seems to be a big task by itself. I've managed to basically pick the data from TechGig site, and it's quite a divergent crowd that I see here. Let's start from the left-hand side bottom. There is a huge number of managers, senior managers, program managers that have joined on today's call or potentially are still joining in. And then there is a good number of people who are software developers and programmers. There's also a big crowd which is freshers and who's trying to understand what they would want to do in their careers. So it's a quite a divergent crowd. We have a couple of very senior folks as well. We have a couple of VPs, senior VPs, CIOs and CTOs on call as well. So welcome to you all. It's quite a good spread across location. Was not expecting something beyond Bangalore, Mumbai, Chennai, Pune, some of the typical IT hubs, but was quite surprised to see people coming in from Punjab and Ajmer and Agra and Noida, all follower places. Yes, of course, there are some data quality issues as well. There is Dubai and Iran and Paris as well. Nevertheless, again, good spread from companies who have joined in for this topic. A huge crowd from freshers, IBM, Cognizant, TCS, Emphasis. Not much of Accenture though, which is good. Either it's because that they have run away for Friday evening, or probably they know everything about data visualization. I don't know what's the reason, but there are just two or three people who have joined in. Any which ways, it was have been quite interesting to see how people got registered over the last couple of days and ramp up and the interest in this topic. So let's get started with the actual topic, the data visualization, right? Why is data visualization so important, right? If I convert everything that we use for our perception to the world, which includes the taste, the smell, the hearing, the touch or the sight, and I kind of equate this with the speed of data transfer in the IT language, we can see that the sight actually is the fastest perceptor of your information. Second out of that is, of course, the touch, which is maybe as near, as faster as USB data transfers. The fastest of hard disk that is available today is about 40 MB per second, bits per second to about 50 megabits per second, but that's almost as less as maybe hearing or smell in terms of the perception that you make up of this world. If you really translate your vision to a megapixel camera, you would be surprised to know what our megapixels would look like. Our eyes are said to be about almost 580 megapixels, and that would beat any camera that has still been, not even been invented. So you can imagine the amount of data that our eyes captured, and it is so, so important in the way we perceive this whole world. We perceive the world with our eyesight, we understand the data, we understand the patterns, all of that is kind of first received by your sight, and hence it makes the data visualization so much important. Right? Even though that the visual senses make up 90% of our perception, we still basically use to a very large extent representations which are not intuitive enough to our visual eyesight or to our brain. And some of the examples are like pie charts and bar charts, which have been traditionally used in the business intelligence world. But we all know that they actually start failing at a point to represent the data in a more accurate way. Most of the tools have actually failed. BI tools have also failed to kind of, give an ability to do discovery or to detect patterns. There is a huge amount of rigidity that is there, where you have to define fixed set of hierarchies, and you cannot basically jump between the hierarchies, and it's far more complex to kind of, really discover data, and especially when in big data world, your data sizes are going to terabytes and petabytes. With that, there is of course a new trend that has been catching up, which we are calling as data visualization. Let's see basically what is data visualization and how it is different from our traditional business intelligence. So the data visualization uses the visual perception to its advantage. It basically represents large amount of data than what you could typically do with a pie chart or bar chart, and you can absorb. And it certainly has to be an engaging and a memorial experience so that it leaves a good amount of understanding of data and a good amount of ability to kind of bring out insights from the data which are actionable, right? It moves the data away from the traditional BI tools that have been used in the BI tools. Like for in this example, where the data is actually plotted on the basketball field itself. So in the background, you can see a light basketball field. And you can see that this person, Kevin Durant, the way he has been shooting goals at the goalpost, and where he has been very potent and dangerous, based on the color coding and the number of attempts, you can see that the larger the hexagon, he has got more number of attempts, and the redder the color, the red deep color is where he has been very dangerous. So you as an opponent team now exactly knows how to defend Kevin Durant and which is his strength. He is a person who is actually more of a straight shooter. So if you kind of stop this person right at the front of the post, you may manage to probably save some of the goals for you. So this kind of almost captures the entire profile for Kevin Durant as a player on a single small sheet, where you can actually start creating some insights and tactics in terms of how do you deal with such a player. Right? So it conventionally takes away the way of representing large amount of data in tables, in some of the older graphics, and it makes it very, very intuitive for people who want to use the data, can readily start inferring and using the data. So that's basically what the data visualization promises us. Has it been a new technology or a new trend? I just probably want to spend 2 minutes on history. Not that everybody likes history, but it might be very useful to look at two good examples that have been used in past to basically prove a point or to make a point, right? The title has been put there on purpose. It's certainly not 21st century technology. It has been used since 18th centuries to make a point or to prove a point. If you have seen these stories before, these are great examples, some of the ones that have been referred repeatedly in industry and specifically in data visualization to understand the power of data visualization. If you look at the left-hand side, it's basically a story from 1850s from London, where John Snow was trying to research huge number of deaths in one of the cities closer to London. And you can see that, you know, he has used a simple map. Let me just zoom it up for you. What he did was simply started to put a single line for every death on the street beside the houses, and he just basically went around to do the survey and marked a single line for every single survey. London at that point in time was thinking that these deaths are happening because of some airborne diseases or viruses, but John was very quick to infer that deaths are happening very rapidly and quickly in the areas which are very close to this pump, and there is some water contamination that's happening and that's causing the death. He was the first person to say that cholera is a waterborne disease and it spreads through dirty water, and London was in complete denial, saying that our water qualities are very high, it cannot be the case. Later on they figured out that there was a leakage in the underwater drainage systems which was leaking huge amount of dirty water into the good water or into the pump. There stands the pump. It still stands in the London, in the city. If you basically visit there, you will find this in his memorial. The pump still stands there. That's essentially the power of data visualization. And on the right is also an equally a very strong story from Nightingale Florence. She has done some good amount of work in India as well. So if you kind of do some research, you will find that she was doing some good amount of work in India during British times as well. She was attached with military, but she was serving as a nurse or a assistant doctor in the medical teams. And she figured out that the deaths are actually not happening because of wounds in the war, but they are happening because of the uncleanliness and the wrong means of treating patients or the unclean equipments that are used during the operations. So she managed to basically put in a whole new theory around how to make sure that the equipments are sterilized and used properly. And you can see that over a period of about 24 months, she was able to drastically cut down the number of deaths, which is shown in the pink and the black color. You can see that has gone down drastically. Right. Again, this is 18th century. So the data visualization has been used to make a point. It's a very powerful tool. If you use it rightly, it basically brings out the message very quickly, and people are able to infer in terms of what needs to be done. Yeah, with that, let me move on. The flip of the slide was again intentional, and I don't have basically opinion of hands out here, but I hope almost all of you were able to read what was there on the screen, and let me bring it back for you. And probably you were able to read it despite the fact that there are so many spelling mistakes out there, but you were able to still read it because our brain doesn't necessarily have to read every single letter to kind of, you know, make sense out of it, right? This is basically the power of our perception. The brain basically perceives information and it processes using some of our autonomous parts of the brain where you don't have to really read to or see through the entire data. This is called as a visual advantage, right? What makes it so unique? For example, out here, you can see that there are different characteristics of shapes and visuals that make it very that make it very strong, and it kind of catches your subconscious even before your conscious is aware about it. For example, we all know that red color immediately catches our attention, and we don't really have to think that the red color represents danger, right? This attributes of pre-attentive attributes like the thickness of the color, the size of the circle, the motion, the color, the curvatures, like all of these are very interestingly used in a data visualization. That basically makes sure that in a very small amount of time, a person is able to, you know, grab attention and kind of focus on where there is a specific pattern or a specific message that can be derived out of all the noise and all the terabytes and petabytes of data that we have. Let's go on to see what are the different types of data visualization, right? This is not necessarily types of data visualization, but this is how data visualization could be categorized. There could be more ways, but I think these are at least the bare minimum ways that we would need to kind of understand. Let's start from the top left corner, the explanatory and the exploratory. The explanatory are simple data visualizations where you have to explain some numbers, where you know the facts and you want to kind of pass the message. You would want to kind of give the message to your the CXO saying how the sales are happening, how the campaigns are running, what are the products that are making sense, you know, which regions are doing good. Those are all just explanatory. You're just explaining the facts. Whereas the exploratory is where you really do not know what's causing a drop in a sale or what's causing a product to kind of shoot up suddenly out of the roof in terms of its sale. What is making the customers lose? What is causing the churn? That is all exploratory, where you have to really start going through a stack of data and hopefully you would be able to kind of derive some insights and then take it back to business to validate if it makes sense. Let's move on to the objective and persuasive. Objective categorization is more where you can actually just pull the numbers and give the facts and the numbers, whereas persuasive is where you have to make a point, something in the like the example that we just saw before, where John wanted to make a point that cholera is something which is not airborne, it is waterborne and it is caused by bad quality of water. He had a hypothesis and he wanted to pursue his hypothesis with data visualization, and that's what he did. That's the perseverance. Infographics and data visualization almost very similar, but infographics is probably more one time, where you would use one time data sets and make storyboards, and this is what you will see very, very rapidly in newspapers going from today or tomorrow, where you will start seeing all the trends on voting that happening and the trends that you would see in newspapers or magazines or the stories that you would see in probably the Economic Times or the equivalents on the economics are more of infographics. Whereas data visualization is something which a organization would want to use in a more repetitive form, which runs off an underlying data set, which could be automated and it could be industrialized. Right? Moving on to the data art, this is where basically people start getting more creative with data and they can use almost any form of the data, any type of the data to come up with a nice art form. For example, somebody basically picked up all the possible colors in a picture and he tried to prove a point that some specific use of pixel and color pixels and colors tend to basically attract more attention of movie watchers. Or essentially, what are the notes in the most famous musics that has caused that music to become successful? And they actually use that data and underlying data structures to prove that point in almost a very visually appealing in an art form. Versus business intelligence, which is more where you would use traditional BI tools to kind of explore and take back the message to your organization. With that, just let's spend like maybe a 30 second on a specific example, and not that we can go through all the examples given what we have on our time. This is an example of infographics, right? In terms of you know how typically numbers are used in advertising and how they are used to kind of pass a very powerful message, and it is typically used using one single one-time data, and that is not repetitive, and most probably it is done or you know built using creative people who have got flair to arts, versus data visualization where we are going to now start getting more into data visualization per se specifically in this session. Okay, let's move on to a little bit of more nitty-gritties. We had plans to kind of understand what are the best practices on data visualization. So I have a number on my screen, 128 glucose. That's good to know that basically it's a number which is giving somebody's glucose. I still do not know whose it is, that's mine, whose it is, whether it is good, bad, what is the trend and so forth. Okay, I just added one more piece of information, which says that it is red in color, which means that glucose is on the higher side in my blood, if it's my blood test. It's still not good enough. Let me see what are the trends over last 3 years. and I basically draw a small spark line which shows what is the glucose trend over the last couple of years. And then it shows me, okay, I've been going up and down on glucose, but does it show me, you know, is it good, bad? And if the color basically shows up on your screen, I've basically plotted a lower limits and the upper limits on the background, so you can see this is essentially where it has hit the upper limits and where it has hit the lower limits. Let's pull up some other data as well, right? Temperatures over last 3 years, WBC and RBC counts over last 3 years, and suddenly this data or the piece of data has become more meaningful than just one piece of information that we had right at the beginning, which is glucose 128, right? The lines that you are seeing are essentially spark lines, and the spark lines have got power to compact in a huge amount of data where you really don't want to go through individual data numbers, but just pay attention to what are the trends. When is it hitting the upper thresholds and the lower thresholds? And you exactly know what are the patterns that it is following. Right? We can make it far more complex. We can use spark lines along with small multiples. So you're seeing basically what is called as small multiples across states. Each panel is representing one state in the United States, and you're seeing the unemployment rates across almost 10 years worth of data. It's more than 10 years. But it's interesting to see that the trends are so compact that you can actually in one small or probably even half the screen, you're able to see exactly what's happening in each state and what are the trends in unemployment across various states. And you can compare one state versus another in a single view of data. If you literally translate this data to a tabular format, this will run into a huge thousands of records. And even if you use best of pie charts or bar charts, it's going to be absolutely difficult to represent this data. Let me pull up another one in the corner, which is a heat map. And this makes it even more denser. And the point I'm driving is data visualization drives the point to give your visual perception maximum amount of data so that you can perceive and digest huge amounts of data in a very short duration. So what you're seeing on a stamp size heat map is essentially 10 million customers of a telecom company. And you're seeing specific patterns of this customer base, which is about almost 10 billion. I can almost select a corner of the data and I can decide to run a campaign with that small corner, which would be still now maybe hundreds of thousands of customers. That's basically which lets you to kind of start focusing on, take a bigger picture first, take a look at the whole bigger picture, and then zoom down to what specifically you would want to do with data visualization or with the campaign or the specific business initiative. Let's move on to see some of the best practices. Here are some of the best practices around data visualization. There's a lot of literature available, not that we are trying to cover everything, but these are some of the common mistakes that we do in our visualization. Using unnecessary amount of ink, which is called as ink ratio. So you can see that where you have no background and the lines being removed is far more readable, and it has got a very slow it has got a very less ink ratio, right? So is the information chunk or the jar chunk, where you can see that 3D bars have been used, where it actually doesn't represent any information. It doesn't give any more value. It doesn't add any more value to your data. It could have been very well represented using just 2D diagrams. But we just end up getting sometimes too creative to show 3Ds and 2Ds, where you can simply have line charts for that matter. Right. So some of these aspects like data ink ratio, data density, charge chunk, and there are a lot more concepts which are very consciously used when you're using or when you're creating a data visualization. Let's move on. Now let's get to the technology part of data visualization. There have been some questions around what technology is used best, what are the tools available in the market, and so forth. Let's take a look at how data visualization evolved over the last 5-6 years and what has caused it to come to a point where it has now become a big trend, and there is a lot of interest in data visualization in IT space as well as within business. As you see that over last couple of years, there has been a significant drop in the memory prices, a huge drop, right? Per MB cost has fallen like anything. The business users have started to get desktops which are, you know, as powerful as servers. The mobile devices are now as powerful as laptops. And you could see that, you know, with the advent of 64-bit operating systems, you are able to now, you know, access a huge amount of data in order of magnitude of terabyte, which could be directly addressed, and perhaps even more in future. That's what we are going to see, right? In-memory tools have mushroomed up like anything. Almost all data visualization tools that we see in the market use in-memory technologies heavily, right? You talk about Tableau, you talk about ClickView, the Spotfire. If you use the SAS or the IBM data visualization tools, all of them rely heavily on in-memory. So, in a sense, the drop in prices, the vendors like ClickView and Tableau were sitting on the fence and waiting for the memory prices to drop. And as soon as they dropped, the adoption of data visualization tools went up the roof, where the tools are are far more cheaper than the commercial ones. And a business could very quickly start using these tools in a very interactive and a self-service BI. It has cut down the time that is taken to that it takes to create reports to a fraction, and that's basically caused a real big uptake on data visualization and tools like the Tableau and the ClickView and the Spotfires. Just to make a point, I've basically brought in the data of the last 3 years of Gartner's BI Magic Quadrant, and I'm sure you have seen that. There's nothing new about it, but it would be interesting to see all them stacked together. So I thought that it would be good to create a data visualization out of Magic Quadrant itself. So at 2011, you can see that the traditional players were all upbeat. Microsoft, Oracle, MicroStrategy, IBM, top players. They were almost indispensable, the giants of the world. But something started to happen by 2012. And there's a bit of animation. I hope you could kind of see the animation as it happens. I'll just give it a time to settle down. You would see that in challenges space, you could start seeing the new faces, the Tableau, the Spotfires, the ClickView had already reached into the leaders quadrant, and interesting changes and dynamics started to happen in the market, right? By 2013, and again, let me wait till it settled down for you, you can see a whole shift in the BI space. You could see that Tableau, ClickView, Spotfire, all of them has reached the leaders quadrant, and some of the big giants, the big fives have started to start dropping down in their position in the market, right? What is more interesting is, of course, I couldn't integrate this into my presentation because this is the latest Magic Quadrant, but you can see that the industry has completely changed. We are into a complete new order of world when it comes to a BI market, and you can see that Tableau, ClickView are at the top, and some of the strong players like Oracle have really gone down. MicroStrategy have gone down. Just waiting to see what's next, and if these big companies spin up and bring up their own products, and if they are able to catch up. But it's certainly a big disruption that's happening in the BI space. We could put this all together in terms of trying to in terms of understanding why the data visualization tools have suddenly become so popular, the uptake has become so popular, business has started to like them a lot, and the Gartners of the world has acknowledged them as leaders over and above what traditional BI tools have to offer. And many of us that are there on the call, including myself, have been dabbling with BI tools. It's an interesting point where we'll have to quickly move to data visualization and understand the language of data visualization to make sense and to interpret and to represent data in a way that people can understand it in a very quick and a rapid manner. Let me move on to the next screen. And we are about at the mid of our presentation, 30 minutes into it. I'll get quickly into demos, but I wanted to leave a small message to this crowd that it's not necessary that you really need Tableaus and the ClickViews and the Spotfires of the world. Those are great tools. But you can almost create data visualization as part of your day-to-day work, your day-to-day reporting. And here are some of the examples where I've been using data visualization, using simple tools like even Excel for that matter, to either show a data quality heat map or to show how I'm going to staff a project with resources and what the resource mix is going to be like, or visually represent my project plan so that when I basically stand in front of client, I can just show them what are the activities and how things are going and if there are any hurdles that are happening on the way. Right. If an architect, you could also use data visualization to show your database performances, the bottlenecks, in a very intuitive data visualization, which would be very easy for your teams to understand or your upward bosses to understand what's going on. With that, let me kind of get into a demo mode and take a look at some of the quick demos that I can bring to the table. One of it is actually a Tableau, and let me switch over to the Tableau screen. And I hope you are able to see the screen. Yeah, you can see the screen. I'll just wait till it settles down. This is essentially, the topic of data is not very great to talk about, but it's talking about accidents in US. This is real data for a specific year in US, and it kind of does a categorization and segmentation around the types of cars involved, the states involved in the accidents and so forth. Right. It's pretty interesting for an insurance company to understand which states are really high on accidents. For example, Texas or California seems to be pretty high, and probably because they are also denser and maybe because of other parameters and reasons. It's also interesting to know which are the top models or cars that have been involved in car accidents, so that either the car makers themselves can learn from it, or the insurance companies can understand how to, you know, put up their premium pricing and so forth. Or the city planners can look at the accidents that are plotted on the chart and see what is the density of where the accidents are happening. And you can see very well there are very specific areas where high amount of accidents are happening. Let me take you to a very specific use case that we have built in this data visualization. You can see at the bottom, which is a heat map, which shows the number of accidents that have happened over a period of time. And I'm actually increasing the number of casualties by virtue of that slider, and it will refresh for you. And you can see that, you know, the heat maps are bringing up all the accidents with a high mortality or deaths in that region. I hope it's refreshed for you, because I would want to kind of pull in something more from here. We typically talk about bringing in data from external world and doing a mashup with corporate world and so forth. Here we thought, if I was an insurance company and I was doing a claims processing, and I was doing a claim processing for a specific accident which happened on an interstate, there ought to be a news report that came on that incident, right? So it'd be good to kind of pick that data and literally search it on internet if you can get some data. And I'm firing a Google query based on my internal data. Yeah, just give me a minute, and I hope it kind of shows the screen to you. Yeah, there you go. So you have basically all the Google searches of Pennsylvania car bus accident where 45 people were injured, right? I can actually go to that specific site and I can pull in more information like videos and news reports and what was first reported by police and so forth. And in many cases, I can actually derive a lot more insight about that accident than what I would typically have in what was reported to me during claims for that insurance. That's basically mashing up a lot of your external data with internal data and using data visualization tool like Tableau to take a look at maybe millions of records across 10 years around accidents of data. I'll take a pause and go back to slides before we open up the floor for some questions. Data visualization, as I said, is very powerful tool to kind of use to make a change. And we've been working as part of our corporate citizenship responsibility on a cause in Mumbai, which is essentially a large number of trees dying in Mumbai city. And if some of you are from Mumbai, you would have seen a lot of news reports or news articles which talks about the number of trees that have died in Mumbai. It's close to 1,000 odd plus. So we decided to do something with it. We thought to use analytics and some bit of mobility technologies to kind of understand what might be happening. So we created a mobile app which could be used to plot the exact latitude, longitude of a tree, and then did a survey of almost 700 plus trees in Mumbai city, going on foot and doing the survey of Mumbai trees. When we did a plotting of all that latitude and longitude on the Google map, and I'm actually just giving you a snapshot, not taking you to a Google map, because it will take some time for it to be responsive enough. You could start seeing some trends that came out when we started plotting up all the trees on Google map for the surveys that we did. The red trees are dead trees, the yellow ones are which are dying, and the green ones are very good. When we plotted it all, we were startled to see that all of those dead trees are majorly around the main streets that are connecting the suburbs. And interestingly though, in the areas which are quite open, where there are open grounds or lot of free space or less pollution and traffic, we saw that the trees were doing good. And this we are talking about specific species of trees, which is green trees. We checked this on multiple places in Mumbai, and we found exactly same time of pattern across various locations. We also see that there are some trees that are dying, which are not on main streets, but they are on basically some of the bypasses to the main street. And you can see that people who are taking basically bypasses to avoid signals or traffic jams take the inside streets, and there is also a huge traffic jam on those small streets where there is a huge casualty of trees. But this started to get very interesting, and we found that we could extend this correlation with intersections where there are a lot of traffic jams and a lot of trees that are dying on the intersections. We saw that the trees are dying extremely on a very high rate of probability where there are a lot of excavations going on because of building work and so forth. And that's obviously because of the water tables that are basically drawn out when there are underground excavations and so forth. We did some heat maps to kind of figure out exactly what's happening, how and where the trees are dying. And we realized that there is a lot of infection and infestation that's happening, which is essentially a mealybug infestation, which is causing the trees to dry out within a couple of months and absolutely die within a couple of months. And we kind of plotted the heat maps and sensed as how these infections are moving from bunch of trees which are in canopy or very close to each other, and how it spreads very easily from one tree to another. And thousands of trees in a line are dying in Mumbai. But it was always difficult to kind of do a survey on foot, for the fact that we are all IT professionals and very less time. We thought it would be interesting to start using satellite images and do some bit of survey using just the satellite images. What we did was we picked up Google images and we did predictive modeling using Revolution R, and we did some image classification, and what you can see is output of that, where we have successfully managed to predict exactly the rain trees that are out there on Goregaon West area, one of the locations in Mumbai. Right. So now you can see that there are so many trees specifically covering this zone which are rain trees. That's a huge green cover, and if all of them die, you would be hardly be left with any of the green cover. We picked up all this data, we kind of took it back to the municipal commissioner. We had some good discussions around the reasons behind the trees dying. We put up some business cases, and now we are working extremely on a close basis with the governance bodies of Mumbai to kind of start saving these trees, put some treatments, put some ways to kind of probably save some trees and so forth. So this is an example where we have kind of used data visualization, mobility, some bit of cloud technologies, GIS technologies, all bringing it together to kind of make a complete difference to where we live around and so forth. So which was want to kind of pause at that with a message that the data visualization is a very powerful way of representing data, learn insights from it, get some actionable insights, and then act on it very quickly. It's very easy to convey a message to either if your business or your IT or your project manager, doesn't matter. If you can represent the data in a visual way, it's very easy to convey the message, and that would be very easily absorbed, and you know, you can see a good traction on that. With that, I'll pause there and we'll open up the floor for questions. Okay, I'm getting some questions, give me a minute. Okay, let's start with the first one. Can we use data visualization and can we start doing predictive analytics with that? That's a very good question. The data visualization tools are essentially built to kind of do more of descriptive analytics than predictive analytics, but very quickly these tools have been evolving in a way that you can almost integrate the R engines, R models within the data visualization tools. For example, Tableau kind of integrates quite well with Revolution R or R. Spotfire has its own analytical engine where you can do predictive analytics, and you can certainly start doing predictive analytics, or you can actually do a visualization on what has been predicted. That's certainly a possibility or something which is already started to be used heavily today. There's a question which says that can you use data visualization to really start predicting, in this case, the accidents itself? So as we've seen the different types of data visualization and categorization, which some are persuasive, some are just basically descriptive in nature, the accidents was not meant to kind of start predicting the accidents, but hey, you can always look at the density of accidents and the population, and you can always use that data to do smart city planning, and you can actually go and correct some of the turns where you have seen a very high data accidents, and you can potentially save a lot of human lives. What we also saw in that bus accidents, if you kind of notice all the high count mortality rate accidents, all the 40 plus, almost 90% of them were bus accidents which run on interstate roads in US, and about 60-70% of them were buses that were running in night times. You can almost immediately know that there's a very strong correlation between buses, interstate and night times, and you may want to start building in some strict rules on who basically drives the buses and who are given the licenses to run these buses on interstate. Let me go on to the next one. The primary goal of visual analytics is to analyze a vast amount of data to identify and visually distill the most valuable and relevant information. Absolutely. I think you're probably just making a point, and there's no doubt about it. It's to basically consume a huge amount of data in a very small amount of time. That's very important because the attention span that you get from your business or from your CXOs is very less, and you cannot really give them a deck with 50 pages. It has to be very crisp and something which is very intuitive for very quick absorption, and that's the whole idea of visualization. Okay, I'm getting more questions. I'll probably have to kind of rush in. If you don't cover all the questions, please post them on the TechGig site, and I promise to respond them on the TechGig for sure. Okay, technically, can you elaborate in brief how we can create this particular visualization now shown on the screen from Google Maps? Okay, so I think you're talking about the map that is there right on my screen right now. This is done using R. It's doing some classification with images. What we have done is picked up the pixels of the rain trees, and that is very peculiar color of green, if you can see. And they fall in a very specific RGB format in terms of its shapes. So we use R to train a small model for it to learn and understand what is a rain tree and what is not a rain tree. So we give it samples of rain trees, and then we give it samples of things that are not rain trees, like for example buildings, coconut trees, other trees and so forth. And once we train the model, we can then basically use to run that model on the entire image, where it kind of more accurately predicts exactly where the rain trees are, and it kind of filters out everything else which is not a rain tree. That's what we're trying to do with Google Maps. Let me go on to the next question. In case of using Tableau, you predict trees in Goregaon. We can say that to be an example of predictive analytics, could you please elaborate? It is an example of predictive analytics, yes, because this is just predicted based on the Google images, and the accuracy of prediction needs to be verified by actually going and seeing the rain tree, if it's a rain tree or another tree. But given that I have done the survey of the trees myself for almost 700 trees, I ended up knowing that these are very accurate rain trees. The accuracy is upwards of 90%. I'll move on to the next question. How predictive modeling and big data is linked? A good question. What we are seeing is predictive modeling has been in the market for last 20 years or so. SAS has been a big player, or the old player in predictive analytics. Nothing new about that. Statistics has been used for a couple of decades now to kind of prove a point, and we've seen how statistics was used in even 18th centuries to make a point. Big data has just basically opened up a new way of analyzing the data and consuming huge amount of data. And in a sense, if you look at the example that you're seeing on the screen, it needs to save high quality pixel images of your Google Maps or maps, and that needs it to be kind of broken down into each pixel at pixel. Just a small portion of the image that you're seeing on the screen actually has ended up creating about 8 to 10 lakh records in the data set. Right? Now if you want to do this for the entire Mumbai, you can imagine the amount of data processing that we will have to do for the same use case. And that absolutely needs a big data to store, consume, and to kind of interpret from that data. That's how basically big data is linked, right? As well as it gives you ability to process unstructured data and so forth. But I think I'll limit that to a session on big data than out here. I'll move on to the next question. How do you analyze what would be a good visualization to represent a particular set of data? A very good question, because you can start getting creative and start using almost everything, whether it makes sense or it doesn't make sense. It comes a bit with practice, and certainly by looking at some great examples of data visualization, there are thousands and thousands of examples and some experts who have posted their data visualizations. You can learn from those in terms of what are the best practices, what are the widgets or the data visualizations to be used for specific instance of a data, and then to represent it in that sense, right? Also, the data quality itself makes a big play in terms of the way you would use the data. For example, right at the beginning I showed the number of people that are joining in from different cities, for Bangalore, Mumbai, Pune. If you remember that, I could have always used a map as well, but the data sparsity was very high, and the map was not a right thing, because you only had four or five main circles on the cities, and rest of them were very small dots, because there are just one or two people who are joining in from Ludhiana or Nagpur or Nashik and so forth. So the map was not making a right sense. So that's how we would probably, almost repeatedly use some visualization, see if it makes sense. If it doesn't make sense, move on to the visualization. How do we gather the huge data which we can use for data visualization? There are a lot of techniques to basically get the data. Just for example, the data that I gathered from TechGig site, and I believe the TechGig guys will be okay with me for doing that. I did a HTML scrapping of the website, and I picked up the entire list of people that are joining there to learn what are their experiences, what are the years of experience that they bring in, what are their levels, which cities they come from. There could be large amount of data that is publicly available, and obviously, of course, there is huge amount of data that is sitting right within corporate. The corporate data and the people within organizations have not even started to use what's available within the corporate boundaries. So let alone the data which is in the external world. For my personal learning, which tool is best as an open source? For open source data visualization, I believe D3 is a great tool, and I would recommend D3 from the open source world. And I'm going to start kind of getting a little bit faster. Can you suggest some good DB tools for monitoring and management of IT systems? What will fall into this purview of DB? Absolutely great question. And I know a lot of you are system administrators, data administrators on the call. If you see the evolution of Spotfire from TIBCO, TIBCO acquired Spotfire to do precisely this. TIBCO is heavily into IT systems and monitoring, and they wanted a tool to do monitoring of their downtimes, uptimes, SLAs, availabilities, and you know all the parameters that you would want to typically monitor on IT systems. And hence they acquired Spotfire, and they realized that this is a great data visualization BI tool. So most of these tools can actually be used, Sanjay, for data visualization on IT systems. And we have a good number of examples within Accenture where we have helped the clients to kind of set up data visualizations for IT systems. Can you please comment on career prospects in data visualization for a person who is software developer and willing to shift careers? Ashish, whether you shift careers or not, you can actually start using data visualization. And hence I put up the example. If you're a tester, if you're a quality assurance person, if you're a program manager, whatever you are, it doesn't matter. You can actually start using principles of data visualization in whatever you're doing. Yeah, and if you become expert at it, yes, absolutely, you can shift into data visualization and then eventually graduate into analytics as well. Okay, so there is a question from Ketan. Can you guide if a consultant from CRM practice wants to get into career in predictive analytics, what are the steps that he should take? Ketan should start with some bit of self-learning. If you can get into some of the courses on R, if it's SAS, great. There is a huge amount of learning material that's available on R or Evolution R, and you can always start with self-learning. When you get to a point where you can start talking on it, I'm sure you will get an opportunity to work on predictive analytics as well. There is a huge deficit in terms of skill sets on predictive analytics. So if you say that you have self-learned and you have the required skills, I think that should work for you. There's a question from Amit Verma. Can this visualization be developed on MS Excel? Absolutely, Amit. The latest version on Excel actually has challenged again all the tools that we talked about, and they have some fabulous data visualization. So if you can pick the latest Office version, you can see almost all that I did with Tableau or I'm doing with Tableau can absolutely be done using Excel, and that's going to be again a disruptor in the visualization space. So look out for the innovations that are coming from MS Microsoft space. Siddharth is asking, can the predictions be included as part of the heat? Can the projections be included as part of heat chart? I'm not sure I understand that question, Siddharth. I don't know which projections you're talking about, but of course you can do a lot of things. Moving on, being in business intelligence role, how easy or tough it can get to predictive analytics? As it is technical business. You are right, Siddharth, again, it needs a good amount of skills on business, but nevertheless, you can start on the data side. The predictive analytics team always needs a lot of data people. You can always start with descriptive analytics and slowly graduate into predictive analytics. As you keep gathering a specific domain expertise, then you should be able to get into predictive analytics. Yeah, there is no fixed answer to it, but many people have managed to kind of move into predictive analytics doing just self-learning. Anything about integrating S3 files with data visualization? The data visualization that you're seeing for the trees, we did use S3 for that. Absolutely, we did, right? And there are some of the shape files that could be integrated in Tableau's of the world or QuickView's of the world. S3 itself has kind of come up with its own cloud offering, and you guys can actually hop onto the cloud, register yourself and start playing with data which has got latitude, longitude, and you can start plotting some good stuff with history. Okay, I'm moving on to a question from Yashodhan. Any way to use data from Hadoop for visualization? Yes, the visualization tools give you access and connectors to Hadoop environments via Edgebase or Hive and things like that. There are some specific tools which are giving visualization on top of Hadoop platforms or open source equivalents like D3, which integrates quite well the JavaScripting in Java. Actually, it just opens up your window to visualization on Hadoop. And then we have 4 more minutes, so any sample data available on net to try R programming? A lot of data is available. Just start googling Anand. There is a lot of data available on sites for R programming. The R site itself, which is an open source initiative, has a lot of data sets to understand, learn and do things. The last question, and I believe that's the last question. Any framework for BI reporting visualization? I do understand every business case is different, but few standard and help. Yes, in Accenture we have our own framework in terms of how do we go about visualization, what are the best techniques to be used, what is the development methodology and so forth. But there are a few things which I can share and few not. But again, I would say that there is a lot that is available on public sites. You should certainly go and start reading on them. Yeah. With that, that's the last question. And we have 3 minutes more precisely to go. Back to you, moderators.
Well, thank you so much, Shitish, for answering all the questions. Those were the only questions we had for the day. That was a wonderful session. I would also like to thank all our attendees for making this webinar a huge success. I would like you all to know that the recording of this session would be available on techgig.com by tomorrow. Thank you all. Have a great evening.
Thank you.